Ladies and gentlemen, with the end of our lunch session, we begin our next session. Do we need a differentiated approach to IPRs while addressing different sectoral innovations, or the same approach is sufficient? For this session, may I call upon Mr. Calab Gabriel, Managing Partner, Lex IP Care. And the moderator has divided the panel into two halves. One is on the role of intellectual property rights in technology transfers in the environmental, in the environment technology industries. The panelists for this discussion would be Mr. Nitya, fellow Teri and Convenor, Center for Global Agreement Legislation and Trade, Mr. Yohei, Sugahara, Director JETRO Delhi, Dr. Vijaya Sarathy, India IP Leader and COE Manager Business Space GE. For the second half of the session, titled The Relevance of Patents in ICT and the Uniqueness of the Sector Considering Its Significant Role in Digital India, including its Make in India aspect, may I request Mr. K. Subodh Kumar, Head of IPR, TCS Group, and Mr. Subhadip, Sarkar, Senior Director, Cognizant Technologies Solutions, to please come up on the stage and shall we start the panel? Okay. So it's over to Mr. Calab. Thank you.
Good afternoon, and it's my pleasure to be here and then also to moderate a very important and wonderful subject, especially technology and IP. That's the thing. And then especially we focus on, whenever we think of IP, especially patents, we always been thinking that it is a pharma which really drives the IP. And then here is a message from us that it is not just only pharma, but also even other important technologies which do play an important part. And so it's been selected that we need to talk about green tech or clean tech. One side, one panel will handle that. Then we're going to have another panel on information technology. Information and communication technology, another panel. So these two technologies will discuss on IP-related issues so that now, by the end of about 55 minutes, we'll have some thoughts and suggestions in order to give it to the government. So that is the intention of this particular panel. And to start with, of course, the panelists have been already introduced. Their names are there on the name boards here. To give an interlude or just to have a kickstart here, I have a couple of slides, and then I'll go to be a moderator here, and then I'll be moderating the session here. And why it is, we all know that IPR is a business asset, and that's why it's getting so important nowadays. And then we know the tangible assets, but now it becomes an intangible, especially the IPRs. And it needs to be protected, conserved, or to be used, and also to be created. I have given here, and like a real estate, developed, defined, value assigned, and to be used. And then also now we need to, IPR will have to be created. It goes on like that. The other aspect is that the various forms of IPRs we have, it's still evolving. There's a circle with a gap there. There's a lacuna, empty spot. Because that spot is meant for the future IPRs could develop in case of time. That's left blank. And in this, the various kinds of IPRs, it's still evolving. And maybe after a couple of years, we'll be having a few more circles there. And what is important is that this panel will be thinking and adjudicating on that, whether do we have to have a new thoughts, new legislations, further amendments on the existing law? Do we have to have an international treaty on certain aspects? These are the things which the panelists will be discussing now. And like, for example, here, what I call the trade secret. And in India, the trade secret is covered under the Contracts Act. Whereas in UK, trade secret has been now governed by a separate legislation. So do we need to have huge generic legislation in order to govern the developing areas of technology? And these are the things which they will be talking about it. So with this, I'll be going back to my seat to moderate the session. The session is structured in such a way that I'll be throwing certain questions to our panel members. They would respond to that. And that's the way it is there. So this is where we wanted to take it forward.
I think that I should have put it back in full front.
My right, we have three distinguishing panelists. On the team, we have Yohei Sugahara. He's the director of JETRO. JETRO is Japan External Trade Organization. He's a permanent representative. He's stationed in New Delhi, and he's been here. And he was a patent examiner. He was in the group chemicals and biotech area as a patent examiner before in the Japanese patent office, and also involved in various policy issues with the Japanese patent office and with the government of India and government of Japan and India. So it is a pleasure to have him with us, and I request Mr. Yohei to answer my first question would be thrown to the panel is IPR relevant to green tech or clean technology? Do we need to have IPRs in that? Because the green technology is literally a life. It's addressing the entire issues of human or animal existence. And we need to have clean air, otherwise what we're gonna have could be a mass suicide. It's a very, very important technology for our sustenance and for our maintenance. And when an important technology, a life-sustaining technology, when you want to develop it, when you want to improve on it, and where do the IPRs play there? So that is my first question. I'll be throwing it to our panelists. And of course, Mr. Yohei will respond to that to start with. Then Mr. Nitya, Nanda, and then thereafter, of course, another third panelist will take over that. Yeah. No, he wanted to.
So thank you very much, Mr. Gabriel, for kind introduction. So I'm Yohei Sugahara from JETRO. As Mr. Gabriel explained, I'm a patent examiner in Japan Patent Office. At the moment, I was transferred to JETRO as a director of intellectual property. So I'd like to answer his question, showing my case. So. think question is, how important is to have IPR patent in environment technology? You know, green technology, environment technology is very important to solve, global environment issues. But environmental technology covers all around the areas. For example, solar battery or smart grid and biofuels. It covers various kinds of technologies. And I think environmental technology is related to technology transfer very deeply because many countries, especially developing countries, want to introduce these environment technologies. So I just showing this slide. So as you can see, there are four types of technology transfer. I just simplified this case. Maybe the first line is import product from one country to another. Just it's also technology transfer. And the second one is foreign direct investment. Maybe so based on this investment, maybe joint venture is established, then product, final product. And the third one is technology license for production by local companies. The fourth one is bottom line is R&D, is more advanced level is technology transfer. But as you can see between these lines, first one is trademark and design, patents, and trademarks, a trade secret. And I think patents are related to all kinds of technology transfer, because if there's no patent right, a foreign company doesn't want to invest a large amount of money. So I think so that's why technology transfer, it's various IPR is related very complexly. So so that's why I think IP, especially patent, is very important to technology transfer. Thank you.
Yeah, the same question I addressed to our second panelist, Nitya.
Thank you. Thank you, Chair, and I'd also like to thank the organizers for inviting me on this panel, and it appears that I'm the only academic researcher on the panel. So you'd expect that my views would be a bit different from other people because they might be practicing or...
No issues. We are here for that.
Well, I do not see anything special about relevance of IPR in ET as such, because if you think IPR is important, it is important everywhere. I mean, which sector is not important? Don't you need medicines? You know, new diesel coming up, so you need new medicines, you're just coming up there. So you need everywhere. Don't you need, innovation coming in agriculture? You of course need. That is, I think, is not very important. But while it is recognized that IP is important, it is also often argued that, you know, IP in fact can act as a barrier when you are talking about transfer of technology or diffusion of technology. Innovation is something and diffusion and transfer is something else. So maybe same tool or similar tool might not be equally good or bad for promoting both the purposes. So anyway, as I said, whether it is relevant or not, another issue is that we are now all signatory to TRIPS, WTO, and you like or not, you have to follow that standards, you have to maintain. But one thing, I just got intrigued by the very topic that do we need, differentiated approach or flexible.
IP policy for almost 3 decades in India. And when we started to look around under WTO, we were asked, no, that's not good. You should have same IP standards for every sector. And we were forced to sign TRIPS, which India did not want at all. But of course, WTO negotiations happen, there are many give and take, so many things happen. But as far as TRIPS is concerned, India did not even want TRIPS to be there.
India thought WIPO is the best forum to deal with all those international issues. Now, we are forced to take up similar standards, similar laws, similar approach for all sectors. We just...
We all expected that in 2005 because we got 10-year window period. We signed the agreement in 1994, WTO again came in 1995.
But suddenly why we hear this kind of, you know, so is it also about, because we see India is facing pressure to get for even higher IPR standard, beyond going beyond TRIPS. And some countries, in fact, have been forced to do that by some other countries, some other, you know, interests. So India has been resisting such pressure so far. So I just got intrigued why you are talking about differentiated approach. As a matter of principle, if you ask, yes, I agree with that. But it cannot be only that you only raise the standard for some sector. So if you want differentiated approach, then you have to be ready for overall, you know, flexibility.
Yeah, we
you
got might the be, point. Yeah, we need to have a sort of differential approach regarding technology-wise. And his thought is that it ought to be on a uniform level. It need not be on a selected level. That's what you say. But anyhow, the same question will be thrown to Vidya. And then Vidya, what's your thought?
Thank you for asking the question. I have spent 10 years in academia before spending the last 13 in a corporate environment. So I would probably leave some statistics for people to think about. Is it better now?
Okay. If you look at the top patent offices in the world today, and just one sector of
green technologies such as wind, and just looked around the world, right? And you know that's one of the cleanest sources of getting electricity into our houses today. Rough estimates, back of the numbers show 10,000 patents filed for wind in China, 8,000 in the United States, and 5,000 in EP alone. The numbers tell the story itself. So IPR is the only way that innovation is protected and investments make sense for innovation.
Thank you. So we have the views from both sides. Sometimes we need to address the public interest versus the so-called monopolies, etc. But it appears that IPRs are important and essential in order to protect your investments, in order to encourage innovation, and then also face the new challenges of the world. We get everyday problems and difficulties. And then some are natural, some are man-made. So we need to address those things for the survival of the species. So therefore, we need to invent. Nobody is against inventions. We need to be creative. We need to create. We need to work. But the issue is that, do we need to protect it by way of monopolies? That's an issue. But yes. We need to have it, we need to create a balance on that. And at the same time, we wanted to see, wanted to just put the second question what is the uniqueness of the environmental technology when compared with the conventional one? Of course, I answered it. It is so critical, important technology. But technology per se, this is distinct from other technologies. I put that question to our panel members to start with Yohei.
So what is uniqueness in environmental technology? I think, generally speaking, environmental technology is covers a lot of patents. I mean, so as I mentioned, there are many technologies like solar photovoltaic, and solar smart grid and biofuels and so on. So it consists of a lot of components and products, devices and modules. So each of the devices consists of many patents. And compared to medicines, it's basically one or two patents exist in the product. But different from this kind of things. So look at the solar photovoltaic. solar cell is consists of a silicon type cell or a compound type semiconductor and thin layer and so on. And there's another uniqueness in environmental technology. It's very severe condition in environmental technology, especially renewable energy, solar battery or solar photovoltaic. For example, for a photovoltaic, until 2006, Sharp, which is a Japanese company, is number one company for production of solar battery. But in 2006, they at the moment they ranked as a seven, and 2012, Qcells, which is a German company, went bankrupt because of solar battery's patent is basic solar patent battery patent is expired already. So that's why Chinese company invests a huge amount of money to another solar battery, more cheaper one, and that is kind of uniqueness. It's different from other technology area. Thank you.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you. Well, in my view, you know, if you want to identify environment technology, you would be wondering what to exclude actually, because everything is now somehow linked to environment. Any machine you run on energy, and now you are talking about energy efficiency on any machine. So everything becomes environmental in that sense. So that I think is a very uniqueness. So if you talk about that, that is important. Another thing about uniqueness in India is that if you sort of still try hard to identify some technologies, we will find that India is at a very nascent stage in these industries, pollution abatement, you know, renewable energy. My friend gave some examples of how many thousands of patents have been registered. I don't give you the offhand figure, but I would be surprised if that figure crosses 50 in India, wind power technology. Indian companies, not about foreign companies. So that's where we stand as in terms of environment technology. That is also uniqueness. Thank you.
Your comments over here. The uniqueness versus the conventional technology.
I think more than uniqueness, it is the importance of having environmental technology.
We understand.
So there's nothing unique beyond that.
Okay. So it's like any other technologies. And then we know that certain technologies are extremely unique as opposed to the conventional ones. Some are like inventions on mechanical inventions. They are very tangible. You can touch and feel, as opposed to a software, which is intangible. And then mostly some of these inventions have been covered by a bunch of IPRs, like not only patents, but also by designs, because the external configuration and shape been covered by design protection. So every article used to have some designs and also some patents simultaneously, so like that. So that's why, but Vidya said that environment technology per se is not distinct, different when compared with a conventional technology. Wonderful, yes. Now we go to the third component, the follow-up component, or the follow-up question of is that, the present IPR laws, we have the statutes, and then also we have the system, like you have the trademark registry, you have the patent office, you have the copyright registry, and then these are the systems to put into practice the statute, the law. And is the existing laws are sufficient enough to protect the creativity, the knowledge which is going to be generated in the environment technology? That is the follow-up question I wanted to throw it before the panel. Yogi?
So, generally speaking, it's not a direct answer from your question, but I think there are many obstacles to file application in India. For example, Section 39 is a foreign filing license, and Section 8, submission of information of foreign application. And more importantly, Section 146 is a working statement requirement. It is mandatory to patent owner to report their invention, working or not, how many product is produced or like that. So that kind of obstacle might be hesitate applicant to file apply. So it's apply not only environmental sector, but also all the other sectors. Thank you.
You and Nitya would like to throw some light on.
Thank you.
Existing law, you need anything to be added or?
Well, you know, I would first ask if something is not broken, why you try to fix it first. So, where is the sign that something is broken here? You know, we just got the law, you know, laws rather, you know, just 10 years back, and of course, there would be some enforcement issues that somebody might talk about. If you talk about enforcement, I would say as far as patent law is concerned, it is as good as any developed country. You know, you would not, you know, can say, show me specific example of patent being infringed and the affected party not getting justice.
Okay. Yeah, your view is that the existing laws are adequate. Probably, they have not even probably tried yet fully because they are just few years old. And then therefore, according to you, it could be the present laws are fine enough. We don't need to have special enactments, additional enactments, or any amendments to the existing law. Okay, fine.
Yeah, I would like to take a minute on this particular
please.
Line. Since you're talking about legal matters now, and I've been a practitioner in the field of environmental sciences and technologies for well over a dozen years, so I could tell you the challenges of being a practitioner in this country, right? One. Let's put our heads into perspective here. We don't want foreign direct investment, right? There's no two ways about it. You want to create jobs, very clear. We do go all and out over the last decade, inviting people to come here and invest their money in the country, right? And whether we like it or not, Indians file abroad, and Indians outside the country as well file here as well. So it is pretty much a level playing field in this matter. With that background, let's look at whether our laws are enough. The answer is yes in some places and no and not in some other places. And I would like to tell you what is the major challenge in it, because that really is the question that you have. From a patent perspective, the law per se, yes, it does seems to be okay. The challenge is in the practices associated with the law. So you put in foreign filing waivers as one issue. When the laws were framed in 1970, so much of it was before the internet era. Today, I have to go to the patent office and still continue to submit where my foreign filing applications were when it is searchable on your desktop for anybody. Okay? So that's just one. Number two, I could go on and say, Form 27, the same section that you spoke about. When laws were framed, you were looking at chemical entities being the most important thing, such as a drug. When you look at IP or patents per se for a system level engineering, which is made up of thousands and thousands of components, it's hard for us to know when we are ready to patent now, whether they will be used 3 years from now when it gets granted. And then on the top of it, if you had a chance to look at the form as a practitioner, it expects you to give a whole bunch of data, which is frankly both cumbersome, challenging, and non-accurate. And if I were to move ahead, I'd love to put one more line on a whole thing that's missing in the country, trade secret protection. A lot of myth is around the fact that trade secrets protect only big companies like us. The fact is the biggest losers of trade secrets are the small mithai walas, the small forging companies, because they don't have access to big notch attorneys. They don't have access to big courts. They don't have the wherewithal. They keep their small differentiators within the company locked up in goodwill, in written form, in shared practices. And when one of those employees walks out with that knowledge, all the other people who work in that company pretty much start losing the competitive edge that brought them into the market in the first place. Who does it affect more? If we as a country want to be leaders in the world, I think we need to stand up and accept there is some stuff that we need to fix, and that's the way I would see it.
Okay. You made your point clear that the existing laws are here. Probably we need to have a few more fine-tuning, so that the creativity, especially in the areas of environmental technology, has been adequately addressed and protected, not only for the creator, but also for the public in general. We got a point for that. And then we go to the next extension of that, is that you also address that some of the problems. What sort of the problems if we face in protecting the IPRs in this particular area of technology? And then some other areas of technology, we have statutory exclusions. And then as a result, I'm not able to protect myself. It creates a lot of confusion and litigation and confusion. Do you have any sort of things that any difficulty and problem in protecting your creativity in the areas of environment technology? I go to the first panelist. And,
just really, so generally speaking, it takes a long time to obtain a patent itself, and not only environmental sector, but also another all sector. For example, from a request for examination to obtain a patent, it takes 6 to 8 years.
So, and if you're lucky. If you're lucky.
Lucky. If you are lucky, yes. It's maybe between more than that. So that's why it takes a long time. I think it faces a lot of companies, such kind of problem. Just.
Well, I will agree with that because, you know, over the last 3 years, we have seen a huge surge in number of patent applications and we are not prepared for that. So we need definitely more patent examiners.
Yeah, you need to build the infrastructure.
Infrastructure, you know, the training center, training capacity. There. So those are, of course, you know. And just one more comment that my friend Vijaya was saying, you know, many of the problems you talked about, you know, those can be done without making any change in the law through executive order. So for me, my understanding is the law is something that when you go to parliament and make changes.
Yeah, it depends.
Yeah.
I could.
Yeah, if the change is a minor modification and a little bit of fine-tuning, probably the government could do that by way of its rules. And then also nowadays the patent office is coming with the handbooks or the examiner's guidelines. And then through certain guidelines, they'll be able to do that. But if the change ought to be, is a major change, then we have to get the parliamentary sanction. The law will have to amend it. It depends on the subject to subject. But, Vidya,
yeah,
what's
so
your thought?
In a general sense, you're right. But I will give you examples where it doesn't work in today's world. Just take the one word, misappropriation. Right? How will you define misappropriation in this country? How will you look at damages to a person who has lost his business secret, has no way to recover it beyond addressing and going to a civil court and getting an injunction? He's locked out of business. A court or a police station does not understand the word misappropriation unless you show him tangible property like a stolen necklace, jewelry, and stuff. But once the cat is out of the bag on a business secret that made you competitive, you have lost it. And those are the issues that really are the biggest scare for companies around the world to further invest. Because at some point, what are patent protected right are easily protected and the courts understand that. But there's a lot of know-how that gets transferred on the floor, shop floor. Those are things that you will say, hey, here's an agreement that will bind that to a contract law. But beyond that, there's misappropriation not by just the two parties involved, but way beyond that, that's the whole challenge of being in the global environment. And for that, if we have specific clauses, and indeed we have thought about it, we have the 2008 Innovation Bill, National Innovation Bill, that has been framed, that's been debated in public, and never been tabled. And that's like the biggest challenge that we have when we want to do tech transfer out. And that is, if TRIPS is something we've signed, trade secrets is a part of TRIPS. And that's just left out. To get business done, know-how transfer is a given thing. It happens every day in all status of businesses. Anything that helps us to protect that from misappropriation is fantastic. And it's not that India has not had a look at it. If you look at it, the Official Secrets Act for bureaucracy, it has elements of it already plugged into it. We just need to translate it back. So if you ask me in a nutshell, if policy could take the lead here, it'll go a longer way to address the needs of the industry.
Okay, then probably, you know, we are really out of time, but one final question that, how the IPR's environmental technology could be you know, modulated or practiced in order to at least address and meet our Prime Minister's the slogan of Make in India. Of course, Yogi might probably contribute. Probably he can take probably a few seconds to do that, because there's a lot of negotiations and Japanese investment and involvement is happening now. So, few minutes.
Okay, just explain.
Then I can go to that.
Okay. Just explain briefly. So I think I propose introducing expedited examination in green technology. So my slide as a second one is expedited examination in green technology. Japanese Patent Office introduced this expedited examination in 2009, and the UK is also introduced in 2009 such a green channel. So that's kind of measurement is very helpful to invest green tech in India, I think. And Azumuna, you may know the drafted patent rule is revealed, and it includes expertise examination, but condition for using expertise examination is very limited. Such kind of, it is necessary for invention to be manufactured in India or like that. So I think it might be a good idea to expand condition to green tech or like that. Thank you.
Wonderful. You're right. Some of the countries do have special provisions under the Patents Act, like Brazil. They can quicken, hasten the examination of the case if your invention falls within the green tech or clean tech. And then there's no need to follow the normal channel of examination. If an invention is on green technology, then you can make a request to the patent office so that your patent application could be examined quickly and patent will be granted quickly. And so probably why not, we can have certain thoughts like that. And then I'll throw the same question to Nitya.
Yeah, well, as I said, you know, we have patent and other IPR laws. We have to have it, the international commitment. But, you know, in the context of Make in India, I am not sure about the so-called FDI patent linkage. You know, I was just given an example, you know. Look at China. When they started getting huge FDI in 1980s, 90s, what condition of IPR system they had, it's absolutely bad. Nothing compared to India of today. Today, China's patent law is much better, of course, but at that time, it was very different. And as an economist, I would go for economic evidence. You know, I mean, empirical evidence is not there. Some studies have been there, but they're more about what we call acquisition FDI. But what we're talking about is that greenfield FDI. You want more companies to come, but then do, you know, new plants, invest in new plants, not like they're coming up and buying up our companies. That way, technology transfer doesn't happen. So in our case, another important thing is that, one, technologically, we are, of course, not very advanced, rather backward. So it will take time for us to get into that creativity. For us, what is more important, like what was important by China in the 80s, 90s, is that access to technology. And in that, our law, you know, trade secret issues are different, but what I'm saying, our law is lacking. We have very little, you know, teeth to deal with abuse of monopoly rights that patent holders can get. Our competition law is bad enough. Our competition law in that regard, if I would be happy if they...
So, I think that is very important for us. And few seconds to before I switch over to the other technology, otherwise I'd be doing injustice to the other my partners who are here. Because time is moving so fast.
In shortage of time, I totally second your guys' opinion that we need a green channel.
Support certain technologies on the fast track for examination and prosecution, and the scope for which they're proposing that expedited examination be held is way too narrow. It would be nice if they could expand that.
Yeah.
Thank you very much. I thank my panelists for this side, that is the environmental technologists and technology. Now I switch over to the IT, information and communication technology. We have two stalwarts with us now. And if you don't give them adequate time, we are probably doing injustice to them and to ourselves. So same questions I'll be throwing. Your technology is quite unique, and it is nascent, it is new, evolving so fast, changing the world. And in this context, please let me know how relevant is IPR to how IPR is important in your area of technology.
See, I'll just cover a different perspective. I think all perspectives have been discussed. Coming from business, if I touch upon the business perspective and look at where IT service industry in India today, we are about close to about 146 billion. And the target is every 5 years, I think we may have a plan of by 2020, some 225 billion, and so on, 300 billion by 2025. So what is important here is when we have this double-digit growth and many players in this IT sector, now how do you get the chunk of that, you know, business growth? I think the underlying point there is competition. So when it is competitive and when we have to create differentiation to our customers, to our businesses, I think the key differentiators is intellectual property. So that is where it assumes a great importance from a business perspective as to how you use IP to create difference in the business.
I think I completely agree with Subodh. Just to add one or two points. So in our area of ICT, one thing which probably you will have to note is that we work in evolving technologies. And it's not that ICT industry itself, all of the companies work towards developing a newer technologies, but essentially we work on new technologies. So whether it's application or, you know, creating some business methodologies. So it's not only just software, it may be a combination of business processes and software, which where IP definitely plays, or patents definitely play a very important role.
The follow-up question is that, is your technology is unique when compared with the conventional one? Few seconds.
Yeah, definitely. Definitely it's unique, but there is also a challenge in the uniqueness. As I told that, it's a combination of business processes, a combination of software, and the nature of the business that we do is not only about developing software, it may be, you know, consulting or BPO or different services. So each of them may have technology. So now when we try to define technology, we have to challenge together as a point. As a pure service offering, it may have services, it may have products, it may have consulting, etc. So, and then the another issue is that we work with a lot of third parties. So therefore, determining the actual ownership and then protecting becomes a little bit of challenge than what we typically see in pure play product companies. So,
yeah, just to add to Subhadip, I think the uniqueness in the technology is the short technology life cycle. So you look at the life cycle of any IT, you know, first of all, it is interdisciplinary. The boundaries are diminishing. You have a lot of interdisciplinary domain coming in. And more important is the technology life cycle vis-a-vis the lifetime of a patent. Say, for example, you bring in something in IoT, which is a classic example of interdisciplinary technology where the markets are growing, whether it is medical devices or gadgets. You see the life cycle is very short. And when you look at 20 years period, yes, that is where we have to put on our thinking caps to see and match the uniqueness of the technology pace with the rights which we are getting.
By the way, is it the existing IP laws are fine enough? You want a little bit of more or a little bit of less? You, please. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
See, the laws in India, I would give full marks to it, but what from an IT certificate, especially when you look at the patent law, law is fine, but what is more important is the interpretation. And if you look at the jurisprudence, which is growing, especially if I want to have some classic examples of patentability of Section 3K, I do not have any case laws. Only thing I can have, very recent ones, maybe the Ericsson case, where the court has sufficiently interpreted the, you know, what is per se and the patentability side. So if you look at loss, pretty much fine. What I am looking for, as my personal view, is more of interpretation, clarity of sections, and more jurisprudence so that we can support the growing industry.
Yeah, I do agree because of the uniqueness. Probably, you know, we have petty patents or utility patents for a short term, need not for 20 years term, because their technology itself is getting changed. The lifespan is so short. And so something, a sui generic law, wherein patents for a few years, at the same time, early grant, it can be granted in a matter of six months' time and things like that, would probably will assist you and help. What do you, what you
no,
thought
I,
about?
I completely agree, both with Subodh and your point. Definitely, you know, just to add one more point on, you know, what Subodh was trying to say, the laws are fine, but then it cannot, I mean, the procedures and guidelines on how to interpret, especially for the examiners, cannot be hard-coded today. Primarily because the technologies are changing, and therefore, I'm not saying that you change the statute, go and change the law. But what I'm saying is that, you know, have clear guidelines which map to the newer technologies. That's number one point. Second is, you know, I definitely agree on the utility, you know, kind of a protection, which is, you know, for a shorter period and can be done quicker. Second is that we also need some, you know, improvement in the efficiency and the procedural and administrative matters. Definitely, that's an area which, you know, we see some traction of work happening, and we hope that in the coming years things will, you know, definitely improve.
Already, the notice that time is over, zero time, and of course zero is the Indian invention, and we taught the world how to count. So if I don't stop it, they'll shoot me down. So I thank all my panel members and see the technology, information and communication technology. $148 billion, and it's going to be doubled in a matter of few years' time, and immense potential, and it is so conducive for India to develop it. And when we are stronger in a particular technology, we need to have the better. We need to have better protection. We need to have better, enforcement and other things. And with that, I conclude, and then probably I cannot stretch it any further. Thank you very much. Thank you for your patience. And then also, if any questions you have, can I have one question from the audience? Yeah, just one question from audience, if you have anything there. Otherwise, now we wanted to make it a little more participative. Interactive. Any one question? I mean, there are two hands, but I don't know who gets first. Yeah, please.
What is your suggestion to the government to look into this matter?
I think in one way or the other, we need to be able to relook at how we handle the word trade secret itself. I think some sort of loose definition of it, a definition of misappropriation, a sensitization of the judiciary and the law enforcement authorities to understand that a micro and a small scale industry cannot afford to lose secrets, and we take our own time to be able to address it, probably sometimes totally inadequately. That sensitization is key to be able to. Every conference we have gone, the people have asked the questions are the MSME guys.
So thank you. I thank my panelists, and I also thank my audience, and then thank the organizers for having this interesting session. And we can't stretch it because of time limits. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Calab, for wrapping up the session so quickly and within the time. And I must appreciate the panel that they have collaborated the ideology of academia, which helps us to a bigger extent to find solutions in a scholarly approach. To facilitate our speakers for this afternoon, may I request Mr. Joginder Yadav, Director, Legal Services and General Counsel, India, Cisco Systems, to please come up on the stage and facilitate Mr. Subhadip Sarkar, Senior Director, Cognizant Technologies Solutions.
Already had lunch. That's better.
And Mr. K. Subodh Kumar, Head of IPR, TCS Corporate. Thank you so much, Mr. Jukinder. I won't hold you back more because you have your session. Sorry to remind you. Yes, that's why. Thank you so much. May I request Mr. Jasbir Singh Bajaj to please come up on the stage and facilitate the rest of the speakers. Mr. Jasbir Singh Bajaj is the Principal Resident Commissioner for the State of Tamil Nadu. So may I request you to facilitate Dr. Vijaya Sarathy, first of all, India IP Leader and COE Manager. Mr. Yohei Sugahara, Director, JETRO, Delhi. Yeah. Mr. Nitya Nanda, Fellow Teri and Convenor, Center for Global Agreement Legislation and Trade. And our session moderator, Mr. Calab Gabriel, Managing Partner, Lex IP Care. And the stage is over to you, Mr. Ramaswamy.
Okay. Thank you very much. And